Keto has become extremely popular in the last few years, and there is good reason for that. It's incredibly effective at helping with weight loss, improves metabolic health, it balances blood sugar, as well as improving digestion, brain health, mental health, lowers inflammation, all the things. But here's the problem when something becomes as popular as keto has become. People start finding ways of doing it that are not necessarily healthy, and food companies come up with products that technically fit in the keto macros, but they're not actually good for you. So in today's video, I'm going to talk about the most common mistakes that I see people making on the keto diet. Hi there, thank you for checking out my channel. My name is Ginger and I am a holistic nutrition coach. I post videos on improving blood sugar regulation and metabolic health using a whole food, nutrient-dense, high-fat way of eating. Be sure and hit subscribe, like, and feel free to share. As I mentioned a moment ago, keto is now very popular with all sorts of people giving it a try. When done correctly, it can be extremely effective for a wide variety of health issues. Plus, it's just a good way to eat to get or to stay healthy. The foods are amazing. You don't have to count your calories. You never need to be hungry. And those are just a few of the reasons that keto is a great lifestyle choice if you're sick and tired of dieting. So let's get into it. Here is my list of the biggest mistakes I see people making on keto. Number one is letting the carb count creep up. In the beginning, we tend to be super vigilant about tracking our macros, which is great to really get down this new way of eating and to get into ketosis and get fat adapted, where your go-to fuel source is ketones. But as time goes on, we get comfortable and we stop tracking, which is fine, but this is often when weight loss stalls will happen. The first thing I encourage anyone to do that encounters a stall is to track their macros for a couple weeks. It is so easy to let that carb count creep up, to begin snacking on things that may be higher in carbs than you realize, or just assuming you know how many carbs are in something without actually looking it up. So first thing to do is check those macros and make sure you're not going over your carb tolerance. Another mistake I see people making is just simply eating to hit their macros and not actually because they're hungry. One of the goals of switching to a keto diet is to become an intuitive eater. Most of us eating a standard American diet, we eat because it's mealtime, because we have cravings, because we're bored, or maybe we need to soothe ourselves. Eating this way gets our satiety hormones all mixed up and they don't signal like they should. Ghrelin, our hunger hormone, is in overdrive and it tells us that we're hungry all the time. And leptin, our hormone that lets us know we're full, it stops giving us the signal, so we never actually feel satisfied. Now, when we switch our body's fuel source to fat and we focus on eating healthy whole foods, our hormones balance out and start signaling as they should. So continuing to eat according to the clock no longer makes sense. And eating to hit our macros, that really doesn't make sense. We should simply be eating when we're hungry, period. So my recommendation is to always keep the carbs at or below the carb goal, hit your protein goal as close as you can, and then eat fat until you're full. It doesn't need to be any more complicated than that. Now, if weight loss is one of the reasons that you're eating a keto diet and you hit a stall, first, try those first two suggestions. If you've got that dialed in, next I want you to take note if you're noticing your clothes fitting better. Measure and see if you're losing inches. Oftentimes, we get really hung up on the number on the scale, and it's not always an accurate representation of what's happening. You could be gaining muscle as you lose fat, and muscle weighs more than fat. Or sometimes, for some reason, that dang scale just gets stuck for a time, but it does always catch up. So if you are truly at a stall though, and you're not noticing the body composition changing, I want you to check and see and take a look at what you're eating. Are you eating dairy? Dairy tends to be inflammatory, which slows down weight loss. So consider cutting it out for a month and just see if that will break the stall. The other biggie I see in terms of weight stalls is consuming nuts. On keto, it is really easy to overdo it, especially if you're baking. I don't know about you, but if I don't think ahead and count out how many nuts I want to eat and then put them away, I can sit and eat a huge container without even being aware of it. So I want you to get super aware of how many nuts you're consuming, and that does include the nut flours and the nut butters. And like dairy, consider taking them out of the diet for a month to see if that breaks that stubborn stall. Okay, next is consuming too much fat. It is possible to consume too much fat on the keto diet. Now, calories don't matter in the way that we've always been taught that they matter, but they do still matter. Remember, your body always has to burn through what you eat before it can tap into body fat for fuel. So if you're over-consuming fat, you'll have a really hard time losing weight, and you can even gain weight. So you're going to hear me say this a lot. Listen to your body and only eat until you're full and satisfied. All right, this one overlaps slightly with the previous, and it might even sound like it contradicts, but I promise it doesn't. There are nuances. So another common pitfall is controlling portion size and counting calories. For about 100 years now, we've been told we need to restrict our portion size and to count our calories. I'm going to link up above a video where I talk all about why calorie counting does not work. But for today, I want you to keep in mind that when eating the standard American diet, full of too many carbs and sugar and processed foods, counting calories and restricting portion size, all that does is keep us frustrated, demoralized, and obsessed with every single bite that we take. It also lowers our basal metabolic rate, which actually makes it more likely that we'll gain weight, plus we just feel awful. So when we eat a ketogenic diet though, once we get our macros down and what our plate should look like, there is absolutely no reason to count calories or restrict portion size. Keep those carbs low, moderate that protein, and eat fat to satiety and you're golden. This one I learned the hard way. Don't drink your calories. Adding fat to your beverage is delicious and on occasion it's fine. If you're fasting though, don't kid yourself in thinking a bulletproof coffee full of butter or MCT oil qualifies as fasting. I see people having these fatty coffees that equate to as much as 500 calories, and they think they're intermittent fasting. But that's a meal, it breaks your fast, and your body is not fooled because it's liquid. Another problem with the fatty drinks is it's really easy to overdo it. When we drink our calories, we bypass our hunger hormones and we never really feel full. This is when the calories do start to matter. Remember, you have to burn through what you ingest before you tap into body fat. And too much for your body to get through likely means weight gain. The next mistake I see is people continuing to snack. The food industry has convinced us that we need to snack or eat 5 to 6 meals a day. As humans, we were never meant to eat that often. Eating every few hours or grazing all day keeps our blood sugar high, which means we have elevated insulin. This is a recipe for insulin resistance, chronic health issues, and weight gain. If you're not familiar with insulin resistance, I'm going to link above to a video all about it. Another issue with eating too often is it's very taxing on our digestive system. Digestion is a labor-intensive process for our body, so giving it long breaks between meals is beneficial. We feel better, we sleep better, and our body just will seriously thank us. Okay, here's a big one. Putting faith in the food manufacturer. As I mentioned at the top of the video, the food industry is seeing this trend towards eating a keto diet. So of course, they want to jump on the bandwagon and cash in on it. They find very sneaky and deceptive ways to make a product appear keto-friendly that is in no way actually keto friendly or healthy. They hide sugar using names that you wouldn't recognize. They use other ingredients that are in no way actually healthy and truly appropriate on a keto diet, like wheat. They love to use the term net carbs, and they're very liberal in what they subtract from the total carbs to get to those net carbs. So here's a good rule of thumb. If the product you're looking at has more than 5 ingredients, it's likely not healthy and you should just put it back on the shelf. Always keep in mind that you are eating a keto diet to get healthy, and the best way to do that is to eat whole foods in their natural form as much as possible. And that means staying away from foods with an ingredient list. Another common mistake is the cheat meal or cheat day. I really hate this concept, and I'll just tell you right now, if your cheat meal or cheat day consists of junk food, you are setting yourself back and making everything so much harder for yourself. You're not only going to get your system kicked out of ketosis, but you're going to spark the cravings again that you've worked so hard to get rid of. So here's my recommendation. Don't have cheat days or cheat meals of any kind until you're fully fat adapted. That's typically 1 to 2 months for most people. And then if you want to have a healthified version of a cheat day, what I recommend doing is have a day where you just enjoy more fat than you normally would. Have some delicious fat bombs, have that fatty coffee, bake some yummy keto cakes or pastries. Now, if carbs are what you're going for, the cheat meal I would recommend is replace fat in a meal with more carbs. I do recommend that you still keep them to whole food carbs rather than just junk food, but this can really scratch the itch for something carby. Something like sweet potato fries is a yummy, healthier option. Now make note, I did say replace the fat with carbs. That means you eat less fat that meal and increase the carbs. You never want to eat high fat and high carbs. That is simply a recipe for weight gain. When you add in the extra carbs, it will likely take you out of ketosis, but as long as you've lowered that fat intake, that's going to be fine. However, if you eat high fat on the day you're upping your carbs, you're going to really spike your blood sugar, give yourself a rush of insulin, and this is going to cause your body to store all that extra fat you ate as body fat. Here's one I see with just about every woman that I work with implementing a keto diet, and that is comparing your results with other people's. We all have a unique story. We all got to our current situation in a unique way, and that means that we will respond to dietary and lifestyle changes in different ways. I see this most often with women because in general, it's harder for us to lose weight. Our hormones are significantly more complicated than the guys, and this often means we have more healing that we need to do before we lose the weight. So what I encourage you to do is stop comparing what is happening for you to anyone else you know or anyone you see bragging on social media. I want you to take note of how you feel. Are you more energetic? Are you sleeping better? Is your brain less foggy? Less bloating and gas, better mood, feeling satisfied with your meals? Are your cravings disappearing? If you're experiencing any of these positive effects from what you're doing, it's working. So don't give up. Just stick with it. In time, you are going to get to your health goals and that weight loss goal. One more thing to keep in mind, and this is true for the ladies and the men, and that is if you have underlying health conditions, say thyroid issues, you've got a lot of stress, or if you're on medication, these can all slow down weight loss efforts as well. But my solution is still the same. Stick with it. If you're feeling better, you're seeing less unpleasant symptoms, trust the process and know you're healing and just give it time. Okay, so those are probably the biggest, but I've got a couple others that I don't think require as much explanation, so I'm just going to move through them fairly quickly here. If you want me to dig deeper into any of these topics, just let me know in the comments. Drinking too much caffeine. This keeps blood sugar high because of the increased cortisol. limiting protein too much. If you want strong muscles and great energy, you have got to eat your protein. Counting net carbs instead of total carbs. With vegetables, this strategy can work. I'll do a separate video about this at some point, but if you're eating packaged foods, never, ever, ever count the net carbs. You got to count the total. Never testing. Once you're fat adapted, you don't need to test as often, but you can feel ketosis. So check in with yourself and test every now and then. Blood is the gold standard, and I'm going to link in the notes below my favorite glucose and ketone tester. Not exercising. There is a thing called lazy keto, and just the name makes me cringe. Years of study continually shows us that exercise matters. Find something you enjoy and do it every day. It will increase your insulin sensitivity and all the other benefits of your keto lifestyle. Not prioritizing sleep. The perfect diet will not get you to your health goals if you aren't getting enough quality sleep. So work on your sleep hygiene and shoot for 7 to 8 hours per night. Not controlling your stress. If you've got too much stress, you're going to have a hard time getting the progress that you want and getting to your desired goals. So put a big focus on this one. Meditate, spend time in nature, get a massage. You may need to consider changing your jobs, consider your relationships. Just get it under control. Getting dehydrated. When we lower our carbs, in the early days, we flush out all the water that our body has been storing, so that dehydrates us. But the other issue is insulin signals the kidneys to retain water. So when we eat a keto diet and we lower insulin, there's less of that communication. So make sure you focus on the water. Not getting enough electrolytes. Make sure you're getting lots of sodium, magnesium, and potassium, and I'll link below some of my favorite electrolyte supplements. Okay, that was a lot. Thank you for sticking with me through all that. I hope you found some of these tips helpful. In the comments, let me know if you're eating a keto diet, and if so, have you fallen into any of these traps? Okay, that is what I have for you today. Thank you again for watching. Don't forget to subscribe, like, and share, and I will see you next time.